This morning, in this session, you will hear voices from these various backgrounds. We will hear voices from the field of spirituality and religion, a speech by Your Holiness Bartholomew. We will hear from science. We will see a wonderful presentation by photojournalist Kadir van Lohuizen. We will also listen to the voices of the young people who will challenge us and ask us what the next generations will need from us. And we will hear responses from the world of business, from the world of the politics, from international politics, and from the world of religion. This is the meeting for this morning, and step by step I will walk you through that. Then, this is not the end of the symposium. In the afternoon and tomorrow, in a somewhat smaller setting, we will continue to work on this and to look at the various cases of Amsterdam, Cape Town and Jakarta. And we will look at several topics where the partners that are around the table today will consider more explicitly the issues, the questions and also the options for action. Because in the end it's not only about inspiration, it's also moving to action. What is it that we can do together? And the idea is that by the end of tomorrow, this will result in some recommendations that will become part of the discussions that are going on for the whole week, actually, in the Amsterdam International Water Week of this symposium is also a part. So that the voice of the values-based dialogue that we are endeavoring these days will be included in the more technological and political debates that are going on. So this is the project that we are on for these days. But let's get back to this moment. Let's take a moment of reflection before we endeavor and before we start in our conversations and dialogues to consider where we are, where we come from, where we go. And after that moment of reflection, I invite Your Holiness, the Patriarch Bartholomew, to give us his inspirational
organizers, speakers, and participants, once again, dear friends. It is a privilege and pleasure to be invited to address this special event that the Ecumenical Patriarchate is delighted to be hosting together with the Vrije Universiteit here in Amsterdam on the critical importance of water for the global issue of climate change. This symposium echoes the worldview and vision of the Ecumenical Patriarchate. The Church of Constantinople is widely known for its ecological initiatives. It was the first to highlight the spiritual and ethical dimensions of the ecological problem, to stress the importance of the contribution of religion to its handling, and to propose ways to protect the natural environment. Already in 1989, our predecessor, Ecumenical Patriarch Dimitrios, in his encyclical on the occasion of the Feast of the Indiction, September 1st, on the beginning of the new ecclesiastical year, underscored the magnitude of the ecological problem in our time, referred to its anthropological roots, and promoted the truth of the unabating care for creation. Ever since, the first day of September has been declared by the Ecumenical Patriarchate as a day for the protection of the natural environment, when prayers and supplications for all of creation are offered up in the Holy Center of Orthodoxy. worldwide simultaneously, the Orthodox and Christian world in its entirety, together with the Holy Great Church of Christ, are called to offer every year on this day prayers and supplications to the Maker of all, both in thanksgiving for the great gift of creation and in petition for its protection and salvation, according to the text of that encyclical. The Orthodox Church's ecclesial identity and theology are clearly the foundation of its constant care for the natural environment. This means that Orthodoxy's interest for the protection of creation was not just a reaction to the contemporary ecological crisis. It was first and foremost an opportunity for the Church to express, enhance, and promote its eco-friendly principles and practices, as well as its gratitude for God's very good creation. The present ecological problem is the occasion, but not the cause, of the Orthodox Church's ecological stance. During our patriarchal tenure, a series of ecological initiatives and actions, international meetings and conferences, theological and environmental gatherings and seminars, 9 international, interdisciplinary and interreligious ecological symposia on a boat have taken place and included participation from various politicians, religious leaders, theologians, environmentalists, as well as other academics and scientists. There were also 2 significant environmental statements, a common declaration on environmental ethics, Rome, Venice, June 10, 2002, that we signed with His Holiness Pope John Paul II, he from the Vatican and myself from Venice that time, along with a joint message that we issued with His Holiness Pope Francis on September 1st, 2017, on the occasion of the World Day of Prayer for Creation. We are especially gratified to see so many fundamental principles of our own ecological intuition and initiatives over the last 3 decades being incorporated into the program of this symposium. These elements include, first, the primacy of partnership and dialogue. Second, the preeminence of values and ethics, as well as, third, the priority of our children and future generations. In the first instance, as many of you may be aware, the vision of the Ecumenical Patriarchate has always highlighted the fact that climate change and environmental destruction constitute a crisis that all of us face, irrespective of race, religion, or discipline. As we have repeatedly stated about this vital issue, we are all in the same boat. This is precisely why our symposia have always been international, because climate change does not concern only one or some of the world's religions. Interdisciplinary, because climate change must be addressed by every political authority, every social segment, and every scientific field. And third, interreligious, because together all faith communities can mobilize the world. This is why we have embraced partnership and dialogue as paramount for any effective response to the ecological crisis. Secondly, as we have persistently emphasized, global warming and the exploitation of natural resources are not purely the consequence of technological, industrial, or corporate deviations, but primarily the repercussions of distorted spiritual values and ethical decisions. The way that we have treated and continue to treat the environment and its natural resources, especially water, directly reflects the way that we ignore the sacred dimension of creation. This is why we have dared to advance the concept of sin, amartia, to describe our relationship to God's beautiful and wonderful creation. And thirdly, as a precious and unique gift, the earth does not belong to any individual or institution, but to every living person and every living thing. Indeed, it does not belong only to our own generation and our ambition to meet its desires. It belongs rather to all generations and our obligation to meet their needs. We cannot possibly create a more comfortable position for ourselves in the world if we do not protect the survival of the planet's resources for our children. This is why we have constantly emphasized our connection to our inheritance and legacy to previous and subsequent generations. Dear friends, the reason that during our tenure and throughout our ministry we focused on water as a quintessential and symbolical element in our effort to advance and to advocate for creation care is its singular and special place in our lives and in our world. Indeed, as the sessions that follow will highlight, water is something that either cleanses or threatens us, because it is life-giving in its abundance or else life-denying in its scarcity. Water is in jeopardy as a result of urban development, as well as rural drought, as a result of agriculture irrigation, as well as industrial consumption, but also as a result of its direct connection to food and hunger. Decreasing water and increasing population provide a recipe for devastation and disaster. More than half the world's people live in countries where water tables are rapidly falling. Moreover, privatization of water resources is not a long-term solution, but ultimately only aggravates the problem. Water signifies the depth of life and the dimension of cosmic transfiguration. It can never be perceived or managed as private property. It should never be either the means or the end of individual and commercial interest. This would not only be a blasphemy to the Creator, but an unequivocal crime against creation and all of humanity. We know that the sheer scale of unclean or unsafe water means that more people die each year from polluted water than from all forms of suffering, violence, and wars combined. It is not difficult to imagine that water bankruptcy will be the new oil crisis of our world, or that the shortage of fresh water could mean the collapse of global food production. How can it not also affect the development of cities, the growth of jobs, the placement of industry, and even the prospect of peace? Clean water is imperative for life. It is important for a healthy family, a healthy community, and a healthy planet. Every living thing relies on water for survival, from humans to animals and fish, to the cities and rivers of Europe, just as to Antarctica's penguins and Africa's elephants. Robbed of its water supply, the Earth would be a lonely place, devoid of many of its present and diverse forms of life. Still, however, human activity relentlessly continues to pollute and destroy fresh water supplies. Of course, according to the scripture, the earth is the Lord's. Its resources belong first and foremost to God, and water is used as a sign and pledge of the restoration and regeneration of life in all creation by the power of God's merciful judgment. This concern for the salvation of all humanity and the preservation of all creation is translated into a merciful heart and sensitive attitude, so characteristically described by the 7th century ascetic Abba Isaac the Syrian, who also reminds us of the close association between the waters of the river and the tears of our heart. What is a merciful heart, he asks. It is a heart on fire for the whole of creation, for humanity, for the birds, for the animals, and for all that exists. By the recollection of them, the eyes of a merciful person shed tears in abundance. By the strong and passionate mercy that grips such a person's heart, and by this great compassion, the heart is humbled and cannot bear to hear or to see any injury or slight suffering in any part of creation. We are responsible not only for our actions, but also for the consequences of our interventions. This is precisely why we must encourage political leaders to be rational and accountable. After all, no responsible ruler leaves one's people unprotected and in the hands of fate. Rather, a wise ruler will assume appropriate measures for his or her citizens. Moreover, as responsible for creation, all human beings are obliged to plan for its sustainability. It is precisely such a visionary leadership that will prove necessary if we are to preserve our planet. For the Eastern Orthodox tradition, water is sanctified, and holy water is used in rites of blessing. For example, it is used in the great blessing of the waters, in the major feast of Theophany, when we celebrate the baptism of Christ in the Jordan River, but it is also used by extension in the baptism of individuals as the sacrament of initiation. In a broader sense, it is also used in the lesser blessing of the waters when we sprinkle water in homes and on the faithful who live in them. Orthodox Christians will also drink holy water either daily or on the first day of each month. In all of these services, the prayers are fundamentally the same, always invoking the descent of divine grace on the water and highlighting the purifying, enlightening, and healing power of the water. In fact, throughout the centuries, there have been many natural springs that are believed to be miraculous. The most renowned of these is actually near the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Istanbul, at the Monastery of the Life-Giving Spring in Balıklı, an ancient 5th century shrine in Istanbul, I repeat, with a long history and rich symbolism of sustaining and nurturing life through the transformative energy of water. Therefore, the sacredness of water inevitably demands safeguarding and sustainability. This means that we must mobilize every citizen and every person of goodwill. And here we must unfortunately confess that sometimes those most difficult to convert are religious adherents. My colleagues, to practice frugality, to cultivate actions that conserve and preserve water, we have to learn to treat water as a precious gift from God. Once we reserve for water the attention, indeed the adoration, that is appropriate for all of God's gifts to the world, then we will do everything within our power to maintain the integrity and abundance of water. It is the responsibility of us all, state and religious leaders, corporations and industries, communities and individuals, to provide engagement with and solutions to a sustainable water management for the future of our cities. Water defines the identity of our planet. So, our respect and responsibility for the sacredness of water as the bloodline of the earth inspires in us the power of hope. Ours is not just the age of climate change, it is also the age of transformative dialogue. For while it is true that never before have humanity and the world faced so many trials and obstacles, it is also true that never before have we had the opportunity to create so many positive changes in people's lives and for the planet's future simply through conviction and conversation. This coordination and cooperation for all people is our only hope for the restoration of a world wounded by the brokenness of hunger and injustice, a world caught up in the cycle of compulsion and consumption, but a world also called to transformation through what St. Paul calls the freedom of the glory of the children of God. Ελευθερία της δόξης των τέκνων του Θεού. Inspired by this hopefulness, we are called not to indifference or resignation, but to transformation and partnership with one another. It is a transformation and collaboration that requires commitment, courage, and conversion. This, in turn, demands the willingness to pursue justice through personal choices and collective policies of repentance and change. We leave you, therefore, with this hope for a better world, for a world that dignifies our Creator and honors our children, which is the prayer of the ancient Orthodox liturgy. Lord, the eyes of all look in hope toward you. You open your hand and fill all living things, from the liturgy of St. James. Send down rains to places and people that need them. Raise the rivers in their proper measure. We pray for favorable winds and timely crops. Finally, we pray for the balanced rise of river waters and beneficial rains. This is from the liturgy of St. Mark. Thank you for your kind attention, and may God bless you all.